So firstly, the project really came about in a conversation that I had with Bertina Wundler, who's our co-producer. He's a awesome man. We're both gay filmmakers, and we were talking about making a kind of a queer South African film. But fairly early on, I think we were very interested in this particular ritual. Because I think, or at least our thinking at the time was that to simply make a queer film for a queer audience was one thing, but to bring it into this rites of passage into manhood was a way of really kind of opening the film up to quite broad and diverse issues. And all of these things that you've mentioned about, sort of masculinity and toxic patriarchy and kind of tradition versus modernity and all of these ideas that are bouncing around the film really are there because of this initiation. So it was through Batana and through this conversation that the idea started up. And then I think it's important to understand that the initiation is not something, it's not something small in South Africa. It's actually practiced on quite a large scale. The Xhosa population of South Africa is one of the bigger population groups, and all Xhosa men, or most Xhosa men, still go through it, and certainly all Xhosa men are expected to go through it. So the amount of people who don't do it are really in the minority. So this was certainly something that is part of the South African experience and that has become increasingly controversial in the last few years for lots of different reasons. In terms of my own relationship to it, this has always been something very complicated and in some ways problematic. I am an outsider. I'm also a kind of a privileged white man, and that makes my own relationship to this culture difficult and something that I didn't want to dismiss or sweep under the carpet. So, and forgive me if I'm digressing a little bit here, but I think what was very important from the beginning was to find the right collaborators. People who have been through the initiation themselves, who are first language Xhosa speakers, who I could work with, who I could research with. And then I think also the story really became about the problematic nature of an outsider coming into this world with certain preconceptions. And so that really was my way of dealing with my own sort of relationship with this world, of going, actually, I'm coming here without any answers or without any idea of how things should be. And yeah, I think it was a way of expressing that.
Yeah.
That was really it. I mean, the other thing was that we worked with an entirely Xhosa cast, and by that I mean first language Xhosa speakers, and all of the cast had their own first-hand experience of the initiation, all except for Kwanda, who plays the initiate. And that was very much a deliberate thing. So I wasn't asking actors to do something that was strange to them. This is something that they've all been a part of in one way or another at various stages of their lives. And for many of them, it's an ongoing thing that they will return over and over again as young men get initiated. So the way in which the ritual was enacted and staged for the camera, this was very much dictated by the group of men that we worked with. So that was another way of finding a kind of access and an authenticity in spite of my own obvious shortcomings. That's an interesting question. I mean, I think the first thing to say is that in the last few decades, there's also been a new wave of homophobia in Africa. So people like Robert Mugabe and various African leaders have developed and popularized this idea that homosexuality is not African, that it's a symptom of Western decadence, that it is something that threatens African culture. So that's the first thing to kind of understand. And that idea is not ancient. In fact, it's something that's been kind of popularized quite recently. The idea of a kind of a new wave feminism or a kind of LGBT rights, I think in some ways has been in reaction to this. So I think I heard recently that in Uganda a tremendous amount of progress has been made because of the amount of attention that's been on that country in the last few years. Various kind of international groups have come in and created safe spaces for LGBT people. So really in reaction to certain kind of homophobic policies, other protection mechanisms have been created in the continent. In South Africa, it's a difficult situation because 20 years ago was a kind of a moment where it felt like we were on the cusp of becoming one of the most progressive societies when it comes to gay rights. We had a new constitution that allowed for gay marriage and gay adoption, and this was all very meaningful. And in a way, queer liberation was seen as something that was being accommodated together with the sort of new democracy in South Africa. But the last 20 years have been a very kind of sobering period, and the sort of the idea of the rainbow nation and all that it represents has really come under fire. It's something that's been debunked in many different ways. And I think that the reality for a lot of LGBT people in South Africa is still quite dire, especially when you look at the kind of poorer or more rural areas where there really isn't much actual hands-on protection for queer people. And really, it's in response to those kinds of narratives that this film is made. At the same time, you can argue that there is perhaps a link between this film and a kind of new wave feminism. The film, in many ways, is about the toxic consequences of patriarchy. I'll say that again. So you can say that in many ways, the wound is about the toxic consequences of patriarchy. And so I do believe that it, in a way, it is a feminist film, or that it makes a feminist statement, and in a way speaks about a masculine experience, but from the perspective of outsiders. And I think that is a meaningful way to think about the film and about the film as a feminist statement. Yeah. I do think so. I think that the people who truly believe. Well, I think if you look at the sort of the powerful world leaders and people who where of the countries where homophobia is having a resurgence, I doubt very much whether those leaders truly believe that homosexuality is a sin, but rather that they're using kind of homophobic sentiment to create, well, to destabilize communities and to create a kind of nationalistic fever or alliance, I think is sort of what you're articulating. So yes, I think that is certainly a kind of tactic that you see over and over again, and it's obviously it's tragic, it's absolutely devastating, but yeah, I mean I would absolutely agree with that. Yeah. Well, I would say that the film does hint at change at the end in a very small way, and I'll sort of get back to that. There are so many different ways to kind of answer this question about the ending. I think firstly, the thing that was important to me is that this couldn't be a feel-good film with a kind of easy resolution. I think that would be the most problematic kind of film to make. I think that the problem is complex. I think that the idea of individual identity versus traditional identity is something very difficult to resolve. And so, for me, I was never going to make a film that presented a kind of an easy or necessarily a happy resolution. Earlier today, somebody pointed out that the character of the initiate is on the one hand quite liberal, but on the other hand, there's a kind of a violence that is implied in what he's saying. This insistence that everything should be transparent and everybody should be free and we shouldn't have these secrets. And that there is something very destructive in that, and that was something that I wanted to show, because I felt that his attitudes, his sort of liberal attitudes, is something that a lot of the audience would identify with, and certainly I identify with. But to show how his preconceptions are also quite limited and naive, and that they create a certain kind of crisis for the characters in the world. And so the ending is really a response to that. It's about kind of whipping the carpet out from under an audience and going, actually, how you see the world and the assumptions that you make about what is good and right isn't necessarily good and right for somebody like Nolan. And so it was intentional to kind of throw that question back at the audience at the end. And some people have been upset by the ending, other people completely understand it, but I felt that was a meaningful way to resolve the story. Yeah.